Welcome to Learning English, a daily 30-minute program from the Voice of America. I'm Ashley Thompson.
And I'm Mario Ritter, Jr. This program is designed for English learners, so we speak a little slower and we use words and phrases especially written for people learning English.
On today's program, you will hear stories from John Russell and Andrew Smith. Later, Anna Mateo presents today's Health and Lifestyle Report. Finally, we continue our national parks journey with a visit to Kentucky's Mammoth Cave National Park. But first,
Mary Meng, a busy worker at a Chinese technology company in Shanghai, says she cannot imagine having a second child. The work pressure is such that you don't even have any time to spend with your child, she said. How can I think about taking care of two children? I have no idea. Urban residents in many places might agree with Meng's statement. But researchers say the speed of population decrease and aging in China means the government should consider with more urgency the effect of this fast-moving, costly city life on birth rates. At a recent top political gathering, China announced an effort to build a birth-friendly society. It seeks to establish measures long called for by population experts, such as lowering childcare and education costs. But the same experts are concerned that China's new effort also promises to try to get more people into urban areas. The plan aims to increase housing demand to support the property sector. It also aims for economic growth through increased productivity and consumption. Urban residents generally produce and buy higher value-added goods and services than people in rural areas. But critics say the government's urbanization plan overlooks basic ideas about how populations operate in different places. In the cities, people have fewer children due to high housing costs, limited space, costly education, and because they spend most of their day at work. Infertility rates among couples in China have risen from 2% in the 1980s to 18%. The international rate is around 15%. Doctors blame China's infertility rise partly on stress related to urban jobs and industrial pollution. China's top economic planner says recent data shows the 2020 fertility rate was 1.54 in China's rural areas. The nationwide rate was lower at 1.3. The data also showed Shanghai's fertility rate in 2023 was 0.6. The national rate was 1.1. To have a stable population, experts say countries need fertility rates of about 2.1. Yi Fuxian is a doctor and top scientist with the School of Public Health at the University of Wisconsin-Madison in the United States. He says Chinese officials are foolishly driving young people to what he called the most birth-unfriendly big cities. This, he argues, will lead to continued decreases in fertility and worsen China's aging crisis. The expert said, "The suppression of fertility rates by population density is a biological law." There is evidence to support this argument already in East Asia. Japan, South Korea, and Taiwan all urbanized and industrialized faster than most other economies following World War II. They also have the lowest fertility rates worldwide. While China's birth rates are also very low after many years of a strict one-child policy, not all is lost. At 65%, its urbanization rate is lower than the 80 to 90% rates in Japan or South Korea. This reality could give China ways to make valuable changes, population experts say. Improving rural living standards with better public services or more liberal land rights would support long-term economic growth better than urbanization, researchers say. The population size is always a multiplier in the economy, said Samir KC of the Asian Demographic Research Institute at Shanghai University. Papi Yu, 21, who works at a film production company in Beijing 6 to 7 days a week, wants no children. I don't have the money or energy, Yu said. China's birth-friendly society effort includes bringing down costs of parenting and education and lengthening parental leave from work. It also proposes expanding medical care for mothers and children and increasing tax forgiveness for parents. Many countries offer such support, but those with successful birth policies, such as France or Sweden, stand out for their greater gender equality, better labor rights, and strong social welfare. Reducing childcare costs does not work on its own, said Yun Zhou, a social demographer at the University of Michigan in the United States. Instead, she argues, the policy pushes a set of family values that demand women take domestic responsibilities. Mary Meng, the tech worker, believes no policy can work until Chinese people start hoping again for a better life, financially. Now everyone thinks there is no prospect at all, she said. No matter how hard you work, it is just survival. I'm John Russell.
Hundreds of California sea lions have taken over San Carlos Beach in Monterey, California, causing officials to close the area to people. Drawn to the animals, people still gather to take photos as they rest and play on the sand and in the water. While sea lions, or eared seals, are often seen at certain beaches up and down the California coast, locals say they have never seen so many of them in Monterey. Lisa Udall is a marine biologist with the Monterey Bay National Marine Sanctuary. She said it was unclear exactly why the sea lions chose San Carlos Beach, but they may be attracted to the food supply in nearby waters. Almost all the seals gathered on the beach were male, she said. Udall explained that the seals move to the northern coast from Ventura and the Channel Islands. They are incredibly mobile. They're usually chasing the food. She noted that the Monterey Bay National Marine Sanctuary has many different kinds of sea life. Udall expects the sea lions to remain on San Carlos Beach for 3 to 4 weeks. Marge Brigadier is a volunteer with Monterey Bay National Marine Sanctuary's BayNet program. She said people should not get too close to the sea lions or try to make them move away. the U.S. Marine Mammal Protection Act of 1972 is the law that prevents people from harming them. People just need to think about how they would feel if they were resting on their bed, taking a nap, and something big kept coming and chasing them out of the house, Brigadier said. I'm Andrew Smith.
From VOA Learning English, this is the Health and Lifestyle Report. Years ago, the traditional advice was to do some stretching before exercising. Over the years, that advice changed to stretching after exercising. It turns out that both advice can be true, and that can lead to some confusion. Stretching can help make you more flexible. The more you stretch, the more you improve the range of motion in your joints. This not only feels good, but it also can prevent injury and lead to better physical results. David Baim researches human body movements at Memorial University of Newfoundland in St. John's, Canada. Speaking with the Associated Press, he offers advice on when to stretch and how to do it safely. It is almost always good to stretch. However, Baim says it is better if you warm up first. He suggests light aerobic activity, such as jogging, walking, or cycling, for 5 to 10 minutes. He suggests to follow that warm-up movement with static stretching. This traditional way of stretching involves reaching your body into different positions and holding them for about 1 minute each. Then you can do dynamic stretching related to specific exercises or activities. This is where you warm up the muscles with repeated movements, like leg lifts. Should you always stretch before exercising? If it is traditional static stretching, not necessarily, Baim says. The better questions, he says, are, should people increase their range of motion? Should people have better flexibility? And that is yes, because it helps prevent injuries. It helps with health. But you don't have to stretch to achieve that. Resistance training, for example, can be an effective form of stretching. Doing a chest press increases range of motion in your arm and chest muscles. Whether you use barbells, dumbbells, or machines, there is no need to stretch beforehand. However, Baim warns to start with a small amount of weight to warm up, and then add more to train. He adds that you do not need to stretch first if you are going for a short run. Simply start with a slow jog to warm up, and then increase the speed. After exercise, light stretching is fine, as long as you do not feel pain, Baim says. Because your muscles will be warm by that point, overdoing it makes you more likely to injure yourself. Foam rollers can help with muscle recovery and have been shown to increase range of motion as well as stretching. If you're playing a sport, Bame says, static stretching beforehand helps reduce muscle and tendon injury. Sports like gymnastics, ice skating, and golf require a great range of motion. For these activities, he suggests extra stretching specific to those sports. If you're going to do an explosive movement, change of direction, agility, sprint, any of these explosive activities that involve your muscles and tendons, he said, you're going to be stronger if you do static stretching. People can especially get in trouble when they go back to a sport they used to play. Stretching can prepare muscles that may be out of shape. Also, he says to stretch both sides of your body equally. Lacking flexibility on one side also can lead to injury. Different studies over the years have led to different advice about stretching before exercise. Bame says that is partly because some studies did not consider real-life conditions. Also, some researchers designed studies with high-performance athletes in mind, and not regular people. If you're Usain Bolt, it makes a difference, he said. For the rest of us, not so much. And that's the Health and Lifestyle Report. I'm Ana Mateo.
That was Ana Mateo with this week's Health and Lifestyle Report. She joins me now to talk more about the topic. Hi, Ana. Thanks for being here.
Thanks for inviting me, Ashley.
I think many of us may think that you need to stretch before any exercise or physical activity, but it seems that is not the case. What did the experts say about this?
When David Bame spoke with the Associated Press, he explained that it's important to warm up before stretching. 5 to 10 minutes of aerobic activity is enough.
So, for example, walking or jogging is a good way to start.
That's right. And then, whether or not you should stretch depends on what activity you are doing.
Do we need to stretch before all exercise?
No, we don't necessarily have to stretch before every exercise or physical activity. For example, if you are going for a run, you can simply start by jogging slowly. And some resistance training can replace traditional static stretching.
And what do you mean by traditional static stretching?
That is where you get into a position and hold it. That is how most people may think of stretching. Dynamic stretching is specific to a certain exercise, and this type of stretching involves movement. So, doing leg lifts is an example.
And what about after exercising? Should we stretch then?
That is an interesting question. After we exercise, our bodies are warmed up. So Bame warns that we need to be careful to not stretch too much and overdo it. That can lead to injury.
That makes sense. Well, thanks so much for joining me today, Ana, and thank you for your health and lifestyle report.
Thanks for having me. I really enjoy talking about this topic.
VOA Learning English has launched a new program for children. It is called Let's Learn English with Ana. The new course aims to teach children American English through asking and answering questions and experiencing fun situations. For more information, visit our website, learningenglish.voanews.com. Today, on our national parks journey, we head to the southeastern state of Kentucky. Here, you will find rolling hills and thick green forests. But beneath the land is a strange and silent underground world. One early explorer described it as grand, gloomy, and peculiar. Welcome to Mammoth Cave National Park.
Mammoth Cave is the longest known cave system in the world. It is 2 times as large as the world's 2nd biggest cave system. Its size helped give it its name. Mammoth, as an adjective, means extremely large. Mammoth Cave National Park is in Kentucky's Green River Valley. The park covers over 20,000 hectares. It protects the river valley and hilly land, as well as the vast underground cave system. The U.S. Congress formed Mammoth Cave National Park in 1941. 40 years later, it was named a World Heritage Site. And in 1990, it became a UNESCO Biosphere Reserve Site. Researchers and explorers have mapped more than 600 kilometers of passageways in Mammoth Cave, and scientists continue to explore it.
Water formed the cave over millions of years. Other than the Green River, few sources of water exist above ground. That is because water seeps quickly into the earth. Soil made of broken down limestone absorbs the water. This has created a vast and complex system of chambers and passageways. A delicate and unique ecosystem exists inside the cave. More than 100 kinds of animals live in Mammoth Cave. Some of them live their whole lives in total darkness. Cave shrimp and many other kinds of eyeless, colorless species can be found. Mammoth Cave was once home to about 10 million bats. They included species like Indiana bats, big brown bats, little brown bats, and the eastern small-footed bat. Now they number in the thousands.
Humans first entered Mammoth Cave about 4,000 years ago. They discovered uses for minerals inside the cave. Researchers describe them as primitive miners. Humans explored Mammoth Cave for nearly 2,000 years. Then their exploration appears to have ended. The caves would not be explored again until the end of the 1700s. Many stories name John Houchins for rediscovering the cave. They say he was hunting in the area when he came upon a black bear. The bear was close to the entrance of the cave. Houchins shot the bear, but he failed to kill it. The bear ran, and Houchins followed. It led him into the cave. Experts do not agree on the exact year of Houchins' discovery, and some people question the story entirely. Slaves played many important roles at Mammoth Cave during the 1800s. During the War of 1812, slaves mined the cave for a mineral called saltpeter. It was used to produce ammunition used during battle. And in 1816, slaves began guiding visitors on cave tours. At the time, the cave was still privately owned.
One of the greatest early explorers of the cave was a slave named Stephen Bishop. He arrived at Mammoth Cave in 1838 when he was a teenager. He learned the tour paths from white guides. But Bishop wanted to push beyond the cave's toured areas. He set off to explore parts of the cave no human had ever seen. Bishop and a companion sought to cross an area called the Bottomless Pit. Its unknown darkness had stopped people from trying to go beyond it. But fear and darkness did not stop Bishop. The areas he discovered beyond Bottomless Pit are still open to visitors today. Bishop started naming different areas of the cave that he discovered: Fat Man's Misery, Cleveland Avenue, and Mammoth Dome, among others. He was also the first to discover a river running through the cave. Bishop created a map of Mammoth Cave in the early 1840s. It included 16 kilometers of passageways. Most of the passages had been discovered or explored by Bishop himself. His map remained in use for more than 40 years. Bishop gained his freedom in 1856, but he died the next year at the age of 37. His grave lies within Mammoth Cave National Park. It was Bishop who described Mammoth Cave as grand, gloomy, and peculiar.
For national park visitors who venture into the cave today, Bishop's description remains true. About 500,000 people tour the cave each year. They are among more than 2 million visitors to the park itself. Mammoth Cave National Park offers campsites for those who want to sleep under the stars. There is also a hotel in the park. And there are plenty of activities outside of the cave. People ride horses on the more than 100 kilometers of park trails. They also fish and boat in the park's rivers. But the main draw of Mammoth Cave National Park remains the dark mystery of an underground world with so much more to discover. I'm Katie Weaver.
And I'm Ashley Thompson.
And that's our program for today. Join us again tomorrow to keep learning English through stories from around the world. I'm Ashley Thompson.
And I'm Mario Ritter Jr.